on views, please.
Thank you very much, Mikko, for inviting me to talk to you about energy sector, what happens there and how we see it in the Fortum and what we are doing in the area. My background is that first I was a researcher in Tampere University of Technology working with energy sector, energy system optimization in hydrothermal systems. Then I worked as a consultant for 15 years with all energy sector related topics, and now 5 years in Fortum. And I must say that the sector is getting all the time more and more interesting. So new things happen and it's getting more and more complicated, and you really can't say that you are expert in the sector. You have to learn all the time and develop yourself to be able to manage in the sector. So I think you have made a good decision to continue studies in energy. First, I will talk to you about Fortum solar economy vision. And this vision we have had actually some 10 years. So it has been there quite a long time. And when we came out with a vision, it was a surprise to many people. And they said that, are you serious? Do you really think that happens? And what is our vision? Our vision is that industrialization globally has been built on oil, coal and gas. And during those times, it was actually that we made the world better with them. Let's take an example of London in 1930s. Then the heating was very local with coal, and they had to cancel sometimes presentations in theater because people couldn't see from the last rows to the stand here because there was so much smoke in the city. And so they built bigger power plants with coal, and it was bringing cleaner air for them during those days. So it was a huge step. But now what we have to do, because of climate change and because these reserves are not abundant, we have to move to renewables. And that means in addition to hydro and biomass, especially sun and wind. And when we made the vision, we said that, okay, that this is the long-term vision. It takes tens of years to go there. It will take tens of years. But what we didn't actually understand was that the impacts to the electricity and energy market happen much faster. And we have seen those impacts already now. I will have some examples to you later on. But what it meant for us was that we have to figure out how we can bring more flexibility to the energy system, because there's not always windy, there's not always sunshine, and you have to keep the balance in the system. Every second, demand and supply have to be in balance. So we have to find new ways how to balance the system. In history, consumption has been very, very stable, that it has not been flexible, but we have there a lot possibilities to bring flexibility. And typically, when you bring flexibility from the consumption from, for example, households, we can improve the living conditions of people at the same time. So it doesn't mean that if you bring flexibility from the households, then you are feeling cold and you don't get warm water or whatever, but it makes your life better. So that's why we included these orange bubbles to the system. We have to have more energy storages in the system. We have to have demand response to the system. And to connect electricity systems of different countries more to each other, which helps the system also. And after we integrated this, we understood that actually it's not only about energy, it's also we talk about waste, we talk about biomass as a whole. So waste, we have to circulate waste much more than we are doing nowadays. So the philosophy is that you have to use from waste everything you can, and the rest you can use as fuel in power plants, but only after you have taken all what you can. And actually, it's the same for biomass, that first you have to make something more valuable from the biomass, for example, replace plastics, replace textiles, replace chemicals, and after there's nothing else you can do, you will produce energy of biomass. So the whole issue is getting all the time more and more complicated and a bigger context, and it's not so easy to say always that what is optimal and what is not. Let's start of the technology development, what has happened during the last years. IEA is International Energy Agency, and they make forecasts of the power production system. And here you can see the forecast of how much we have wind and solar in the system. For example, here you can see the forecast at 26, what they made. And here you can see what are actually the actual figures. And they have failed every year to forecast how much will be the production of wind or solar. And if we look nowadays, we have wind something like this. So last forecast in this figure is wrong, and the same with solar. So that they have failed in forecasting. Why they have failed? They have failed because the costs of the technologies have declined faster than they thought before. And it's always very difficult then to really predict something that the development is accelerating instead of linear development, for which we are used to in our sector. Actually, it didn't happen so much in the technologies during the last several decades, but now it has happened a lot during last 10 years. Another example is about battery technology costs. Here you can see technology costs since 2011. It has declined to some one-fourth in just a few years. It has to do a lot with industrialization, but anyhow, batteries are more and more cheaper, and that means also that the electric vehicles are getting day by day cheaper. So we are now approaching the situation that actually lifetime costs of electric vehicles are cheaper than with petrol cars. And just in some 5 years, they are cheaper also in the purchase price. And that makes a huge shift in traffic, moving traffic from liquid fuels, mostly fossil fuels, to electricity. And makes a lot of good impacts, for example, in the air condition in the cities. So just these two examples show that there is a lot happening also in the technologies. So the market, which is a lot regulation driven, there is not now much which is technology driven. And what it means for the electricity energy system? We already know that actually solar and wind will be already are the cheapest way to produce electricity. If you only think energy and you don't think that when the energy is available. So when we are here nearby equator, solar is the cheapest way to produce electricity, and there is not so much seasonality in the system. There is no really winter and summer. So if you combine solar here with storage, like battery storage, you can manage here quite well, and it might be that they don't actually build transmission grids which are so strong what we have nowadays, because they don't really need it and it's too expensive for them. For us, it's wind is the cheapest way of to produce electricity, but we are still having winter and summer, which means that we have a lot of seasonality energy consumption, and we have to manage the situation. And it's not so easy to move energy from summer to winter, and that is why we have to find what is the best systemic way to do that optimization in our areas, which is different from the equator. Here I have some examples of the prices of solar and wind, and some scenarios what it could be. These are the lowest public prices of wind and solar, so both are around 26 euros per megawatt hour. And we can still see that there is happening a lot in the technology development, so that is not yet the limit. We can go below that, and that will happen. And of course, that brings a quite interesting situation to the energy system. If you think that you now use some fuel and combust it in a power plant, what is the price that you can get fuel, for example, biomass? It's making the situation very, very challenging. We have some predictions or forecasts, but these are quite conservative. So most probably the prices will go down faster than the figures what you see there. Then let's take an example how you can see impacts in the electricity market already now. I have a comparison of Finland and Germany. It's already 3 years old figures, but it doesn't matter, but the impact is there. It's even bigger. But here is 1 month, December, and monthly average price has been quite the same in both market areas. But when we take an hourly price, you can see that there is quite a huge difference between Germany and Nordics. So quite minor hourly differences in Nordics, but in Germany, during the same day, it's a huge difference. And look the scale, here is zero. We have there a few hours when electricity market price has been negative. And sometimes I have been asked that what does it mean that the price is negative? So it really means that from the electricity market, if you consume electricity, you are paid of that. Of course, there are the transmission costs, what you can't avoid. But just thinking of the energy production price, you are paid of consuming electricity. And that happens more and more often. And now, if we think of Germany, it's not so much actually wind and solar yet in the system. It's some 10-15% only. And you already see this impact, what is happening. It has something to do with the regulation, but anyhow, the impact is quite huge. And then we will have a look of 1 week. Or is it? It's 1 month, yes. Here we have conventional production, which is typically coal and gas-based conventional power. Then green here is wind, and this yellow or orange is solar. You can see very easily the daily variation of solar. And what is the impact? You can see that there is actually from the consumption perspective, there is a problem during mornings and problem in the evenings. And conventional power is then taking care of the morning peak and evening peak. And you can also see in prices that there is a peak in the morning and peak in the evening, so that we can balance the system. But there is one interesting week here in the middle. From Monday to Friday, you can see that there is very small amount of wind power in the system, so there is not so much wind. What happens in Friday afternoon? It happens to start winding a lot. You can see that the wind power production increases just in a few hours something like 20,000 megawatts, which means that that's much more than the typical production or capacity in Finland in a few hours. So the other system has to manage that huge change, so that you can see that conventional production goes down huge amount. So this is really, really a big systemic challenge in the energy market, that how to manage these situations. And here we have only a small amount of wind and solar. What happens when it's 50% wind and solar, or even more? So this means that the system and the market has to be such that it really takes into this into account and rewards if you are able to be flexible in the system. So this is what is happening in the system. Technologies, new technologies getting cheaper and cheaper, and when we have more wind and solar in the system, we need much more flexibility in the whole system to manage it. So that was our vision already 10 years ago, and I joined Fortum 5 years ago, and in our development work we have used that vision as guidance what we are doing. And a year and a half ago, we renewed our strategy. We built it on the mega trends, which I think are quite clear to all of us. In mission, we said first time customer. Before we have talked that we provide energy to society and welfare, but now we want to find and develop new services to customers. We want to help customers to take part of this, to work for a cleaner world, but so that it's easy for the customers. We formulated our strategy in 4 areas. First, with present assets, nuclear, hydro, conventional power plant, CHP, we have to be more and more productive. And we know that these assets are still for a long time in the system. We have to keep them competitive in the system. We want to grow in solar and wind because we see that they are getting more and more important in the system. And that is what we have already done in some extent. We want to create solutions for sustainable cities. So before we were actually selling district heat or electricity, but now we also want to expand that, for example, to bring waste treatment and waste circular economy concepts to help the cities to tackle their challenges. And there is one mark of that area is that a year ago we acquired a company called Ecochem from Finland to really bring their waste solutions to expand those operations. And then where I'm working most, we are building new energy ventures. So we understand that nobody really knows what will happen in the energy market. Before, we have made most of our profit in selling power to electricity Nord Pool system. But we have to find new, strong businesses in addition to that. And this is where I'm working, and I will bring you some examples of what we are doing and how we are doing. And this is something that we have put a lot of effort that how we can serve our customers better, how to make them easier to make solutions and still make from the society point of view good solutions. And I think we still the way is still long to go, but we want to put effort on there. And we, for example, developed a design lab a year ago to really develop new services and new service concepts and try them. Electric vehicles, that's one of my favorite topics. And that change will be much faster than many of people think. It just is coming. And we have now worked for some 5 years developing charging infrastructure. We started it in Norway, now we are in Finland and Sweden with our own Fortum brand. So that when we are there with Fortum brand, we will bring the poles, we will do the invoicing, we will do safe charging with our software. But we are also selling that as a service to other players, so that we will bring them as a white label our service, and then local player can have their own poles and own brand. For example, in Finland, Suursavon Sähkö is using our service. And now our platform is used in 11 countries at this moment. So there are a lot of other players in that sector. And I'm happy to see that it's also in Finland starting to get interest, and then we will have more charging infrastructure here also. Norway is, of course, leading the development. I think globally China starts to move ahead, but from Western countries, Norway is the best. And it's also good that there are competitors. And for example, in Finland, we have a company called Virta in the same area, which is owned by municipal energy utilities. And it's always good that there are several players doing the same thing and competing with each other and following each other. Then about the flexibility in the energy system. This is something we have done, I think, among the first ones globally. And what we did, we started this a year and a half ago. What did we do? We aggregated household water heaters. And when we talk that we aggregate them, we made together a 100 kilowatt so-called load, and we sold that to Fingrid to balance the electricity system. So it's really to the fastest frequency regulation market. And of course, it's used so that people get always the warm water, so they will not have to worry if there is cold shower only available. But we use only those heaters when it doesn't harm the people. And we have done this with the Fingrid normal agreement, so they didn't have to do anything special. And this was trial for both of us, that are we able to do with this with the normal contract structure. First, we did this in Finland. Then we piloted it in Sweden. And I must say that I'm happy with the Finnish TSO Fingrid, that they really, they want to develop this area. They were positive, they were very, it was very good cooperation. When in Sweden, it was more like we contacted administrators, and it was not so easy at all. And now we are expanding this in Finland to have 1,000 or 2,000 households to bring to the system. And one of the challenges here is actually, if you think that you will bring one water boiler to the system, it's not actually so much money per one water heater. And then it's a question that how to develop such a service for customers. It's, you can't sell it for them that you get savings, but you have to find some other angle for customers. And in the first case, customers wanted to just be in something which is new, where we developed a system which is good for the system. And they also got all the time they could see their electricity consumption. So that was enough, that stage. But it's not enough in the future. We have to develop that. But what we want to build for Fortum of that concept is we want to build a virtual power plant where we have different type of electricity consumption. We can pull them together and we can bring them to different markets depending on the market situation, that which market is best for those assets. It can be households, like we had their heaters. People can have battery storages. It can be electric vehicles, either so that you optimize how you charge the EV, or it might be also that you can feed electricity from the car battery to grid. If you have followed the sector, it's last week Helen announced the first pilot in the vehicle to grid. And that is a huge opportunity. If you think that all the Finnish personal cars were electric vehicles, the capacity in the battery storages would be several times higher than we have the whole power production capacity in Finland at this moment. And that would be a huge flexibility source to the system. And also, of course, car owners would get benefits. It was just recently calculated for Denmark case that if you could bring a car battery to be part of the electricity system, the earnings per car per year would be 1,500 euros. So it's already, it's a lot. So it's so much that then it's worth doing, and it's enough for car owners and those who optimize the system. So this is what we want to build. And we also want to build it so that it's open, so that you don't have to be Fortum customer to be part of our virtual power plant. We have to find a way to do that. And that's actually, this topic is very, very interesting. There are a lot of startups working in that sector, both Nordics, both USA, other countries. But let's not forget the district heating. I know it's not so fancy to talk about heating. Electricity is so much nicer. But here, heating is very important, crucial part of the energy system. This is the way how we can really balance the system and get the benefits. And why is it so? If you think of district heating, and you have a system where you have, for example, combined heat and power plant, you have heat-only boilers, you have data centers, you have heat pumps, what else? That means that it's very flexible and it can support the electricity system. Let's say that there is so much wind, a lot of wind power in the system. Then you can decide, okay, let's produce district heat with heat pump. When there's no wind, then you will use combined heat and power plant, because then you can at the same time produce electricity. Or you can use to be a neutral towards electricity market. So district heating systems are crucial for us if we really think of how to optimize the systemic cost for us, which is then benefits all of us. And it's actually, if we think of these some parts here, heat from data centers. Some data centers say that they get all their electricity from renewable sources, but actually it's much more environmental friendly if they get their cooling from district heating networks. So that it means that First, you get the cooling from district heat, but you also get bring all the excess heat back to the district heating network. And it's some, are we already talking some 10-20% of district heating in Espoo after we get the next investment ready, which we get from data centers? So it's actually a huge impact, remarkable sources for heat. Then we talk about Fortum heat pilot, from steering to controlling heat. And I think there's quite a lot to do in district heating. Nowadays, it's not, when you steer district heat, you don't use the indoor temperatures for the steering. So it typically leads to a situation that in the same apartment building, the temperature differences between the apartments can vary some 4 or 5 Celsius degrees even. So this is quite simple. We will measure the temperature in apartments and we will optimize the building. And already doing that, the building saves typically some 15% of costs. And then we can go further. From this, we can go to district heating demand response. The learning algorithm knows every building how much it can store energy in the walls, and you can then optimize it. But for that, you need hourly price for district heat, so that you really can get the benefits. And this is, I see how where district heat has to go. And furthermore, it has to go that you have a smart thermostats, so that you can decide what temperature you want to have in your apartment. Somebody likes 20, somebody 24, but then they have to also pay off that heat. So that means that heat cost is not anymore part of this, what is it in English, this vastike, what you pay as a lump sum, but then you pay separately of the heating. And I see that this is important for district heat really to go that direction, but there's still long way to go. This is a nice example. Fortum horsepower. How many has heard of Fortum horsepower? Some. Very good. That was our first internal startup program 2014. And two guys from nuclear risk management came with this idea. Could we start selling services to horse stables? Let's bring them the bedding, and then we will take the manure away, and then we will bring it to power plants or wherever it's the best place to use that. And it sounded a nice idea that just go ahead, I said to them, because I was the business angel then and I could just say that, okay, go on. And then we brought the people from the real business. They said, oh, no, it doesn't work. It has been tried before and it didn't work. But what was actually the reason was that before the bedding material, if it is a straw causes problems to the boilers. But if you change it to for example, sawdust or biomass, then it's much easier. It's not easy, but it's doable in the power plants. So sometimes innovation comes totally outside from the traditional area, and you can think differently. And actually now they have some, I think, already over 2,000 horses as their customers in Finland. They have started operations in Sweden. And I think what is really amazing that if they could get 10% of European horses as their customers, that would be a turnover approximately 500 million euros per year. Even though that just sounds what a nice idea, but it really could be a big business. Let's see how it goes on. But this is one of our internal startups. So we have, from cultural point of view, we have tried to develop a different way of doing things in these internal startups and give them more startup way of doing things compared to traditional utility structures. Of course, it's not easy. It doesn't go perfectly, but I think at least we are able to do that. Then another area is related to cooperation with different parties. So we have to much more cooperate with different type of players with whom we have not worked before. And here is one example of what we are doing. This is a software service for off-grid solar systems. So that when there is a developer who is building an off-grid solar system, we would help them to provide them with the software so that you can measure the consumption very easily, you can invoice it very easily. So that they the developers, which is very, very fragmented globally, can focus only on the assets. And here we cooperate with a company called Futurize. And this is actually, we are cooperating so that they are not sub-consultant to us, they are partner to us. We are working together, we are sharing the risk. And if that seems to be successful, we might go to a situation that we actually will establish a startup together. And this is what we want. We want to find new ways to cooperate with different types of partners. And then perhaps last thing about the culture. And if you think culture of the traditional sectors where it has not happened so much, typically those who avoid risks, stay safe, want to be certain, work slowly, and pay attention to details, they win. And that has been a situation in also in our sector. And this is actually a Harvard Business Review research from 2013. Then when situation changes, there are some changes that you can't really understand or predict. And now I think this technological change, what is happening in our sector, actually you should turn more to achievement focus. There you want to develop new, you want to grow, you need to have ability to take risks, to try it, think creatively, you have to be extremely optimistic, many times people intend to have different approaches, and in the history we have had more people in our sector with this scope, and now you should move more to this scope. Of course you need also both, of course, but I feel that now our sector would need more this approach to be really able to develop new things and renew and not shrink only. But this is this was the case, our examples, some a little bit what we are doing, how we are doing, and our slogan is join the change, and it really means that we need everybody to join, because the climate change is a huge challenge and we have to work all to tackle that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for a very interesting presentation. But it really seems that there's a lot of moving parts in the puzzle of energy field these days.
Yes.
So now it's time for the questions from the audience. Mm-hmm. First.
So the question was about district heating network and what we own as a Fortum. We own both the production, we own CHP plants, we own heat-only boilers, but then we also buy district heat from some other players, so for example from these data centers which have excess heat, or also some buildings like Espoo new hospital, so they are selling their excess heat to us, so it's a mixed model. And then, of course, we own the district heating network, and then we sell it to customers.
And what is the share about that network? Does government also have a part of the district heating network, or owning
Fortum? Then it's a question about who owns the networks. Government doesn't own district heating networks. Fortum owns in some areas. Then in some areas we have players which are then municipally owned players. But government doesn't own district heating networks.
And how do you decide the price of the heat?
How do we decide price of the heat? District heat is said that it's in the dominant market position. So that means that it's not monopoly. It's not totally competitive, something in between. So it's our own evaluation. Of course, there is competition coming from other sectors like ground heat pumps or these kind of things. But we base our pricing based on that. And then there is a competition authority who is then following the prices. And sometimes they might analyze the pricing of some companies. or somebody might complain of the pricing, and then they evaluate it and give their statement.
Any other questions?
So the big question seems that how to sell flexibility to customers. Do you have some business models that how this could be sold to the customers? Why would they want to be flexible?
So the question was about flexibility, how to sell flexibility to customers. For electrical heating, we have already products to customers, what we call Fortum Fiksu. And there the idea is that customer has hourly electricity price, and then we optimize their heating based on the price. And then the customer gets the benefit of the pricing, moving the heating from the high-priced hours to the low-priced hours. But then when we come to those other areas, for example, this frequency regulation market, where it really doesn't go to the customers, this pricing, then you have to find other ways to do that. Then I think we really don't have yet good examples of these business models, what it could be. But we have to develop them, and it might be some discount or some more benefits. Typically when we introduce, for example, Fortum Fiksu, it's not only saving, it's also to improving the living conditions, because then you can control the temperature much easier, so that you get more stable temperatures in apartments. So I would say that it's for customers, it's more important to increase the comfortable level than to save a few euros. But when you have good ideas, it's just come to sell it to us.
Next question. Please.
You talked briefly about batteries and the growing importance of batteries in the future electricity system. So what's your personal and professional opinion about the future of batteries? Seems like the best technology seems to be like lithium ion batteries.
So the question was about battery technologies and whether the lithium-ion batteries will remain the main source. That's true that lithium reserves or the mining doesn't cover the growth what we can see for the future, and for example to cover the need for EVs. And this is just my assumption that I suppose that what it will happen, that when the consumption increases, we will have problems with lithium, and there is research ongoing with different kind of technologies, but in the short term you really can't see them, that they are really the others are coming. But I think when lithium there will be problems in the amount of lithium available, then this development with other technologies is developing faster, and we will finally see some other technologies also. But I think now it's going so fast that we will see a lot of bottlenecks happening, and then it takes a few years again to find a new solution. So a lot of dynamics will happen.
Eppo.
I was waiting if somebody asked about the Uniper news. So this is what we announced yesterday. And this is actually, I didn't talk about our strategy, but we sold our distribution grid assets just a few years ago. And we have stated in our strategy that we will have two phases. And first phase is really to participate in the major M&A case in our home markets. And we want to develop at first a new cash flow to company. Then we have phase two, where we want to develop new businesses and new strong foods to Fortum. And if you think of developing new cash flow, it's not so easy of these new things what we are dealing with. So from that context, it looks quite natural step what we are doing. You are totally correct. There's a lot of coal and gas, but there is also nuclear and hydro, for example, in Sweden. So, but this is how I see it, and let's see what happens with the case.
Please.
There was a question about startups, that how mature startups have to be to discuss with us. It depends a little bit on the case. If it is some kind of technology startup, we are not really the best partner to start when somebody comes with an idea on the paper. So they should have at least something piloted and proven. Then when we talk about other service concepts, it depends on the case. We have tried something with quite newly established startups, but perhaps we are not the best partner just in the beginning. So something piloted, not so much, but still something. So that would be better and easier to start cooperating with us.
Please, there.
Now it was a question about district heating pricing, and if there's customer who has a heat pump and want to be part of the district heating network. Now, to be honest, I'm not so deep in our district heating pricing and how it is for different customers, but I know we have customers who have the main heating as a ground heat pump, and then they want to have also district heating to secure the heat supply. So I don't exactly know how the pricing is.
I can comment on that, because you have the market, dominant market position, you have to provide the energy with the same price to all the automakers.
Okay, very good. I got an answer that because of dominant market position, it has to be open. This is, true. Yeah, but I think they have to be public. Mm. There's a question about horsepower and how the manure is used. Now it is used as a solid biomass in power plants, because there is quite a lot of biomass when you look at the manure. And the gasification is perhaps not best for that context. But then it's a question that in longer term that there are some nutrients in the horse manure, that how you could get out of them. So I think the main idea in the concept is to provide a service to stables, and then you can develop that what is the best way to use the manure. And now it is in we use it in power plants as fuel, and it's not only Fortum power plants, so we are selling it also to other players. So we are open to develop the other alternatives when they are are cost efficient, but the horsepower concept doesn't do themselves. So this is the service business for stables. Then we have to find partner who uses that manure.
Seppo.
No, it was a question about nuclear power and do we need it more after Olkiluoto 3. From climate change perspective, nuclear power is great and we need it in the system. Then it's a question that how much we have other sources for energy and electricity, how much we will get new wind power in the system and how to make the system work. I think that is the question. But perhaps my personal view is that we don't have to be in Finland self-sufficient in all situations. I see that it's very important that we have well-functioning markets and the bigger market area, the more efficient the system is. So when we think that how to really optimize and get the costs down in the whole system.
Any other questions?
It's not based on coal. So the question was about the electric vehicles and the sustainability. Actually, in the whole European Union, electricity production is part of emissions trading scheme. And EU has set a ceiling for all CO2 emissions in EU. Now, when you have an electric vehicle, it then becomes part of this EU emissions trading scheme. And actually, it does not increase at all emissions because there is a ceiling for that. So if all our cars were moved to electric vehicles in EU, emissions would not increase at all. This is how the system has been structured. But if I answer more generally to that question, there was an excellent article about China. It was from Bloomberg, and they compared that if electricity is produced with coal condensing power and then used in electric vehicles compared to the gasoline cars, still in that article they showed that it is sustainable. Thank you very much. It was a good question about electric vehicles and there were so many things. Let's see if I remember to answer to all of them. First was about sustainability in general, if you think of the production of batteries and I've seen comparisons that if you take the lifetime cost, lifetime environmental impact assessment, so still those come to the conclusion that I don't exactly remember the kilometers that when after which electric vehicles are more sustainable than traditional cars. Then it's a question about the electricity consumption, and actually electric vehicles are quite efficient. So if you think that you drive 100 kilometers with EV, it's something like 15 kilowatt hours. But if you use a gasoline car, it's three times more. So it's actually very energy efficient. And for example, all Finnish personal cars, if they were electric vehicles, that would mean a production of one nuclear power plant only. So it's actually not so huge amount of energy because of the efficiency. Then it was interesting question about the charging, that how to manage this charging. And I think in many times people think that you have to charge the battery is empty when you stop driving, and you have to fill it full within quite a short period. And I would actually compare this situation to the Finnish electric saunas, that I think it's only Christmas Eve. It used to be before that so many people went to sauna at the same time, and we had this sauna peak, or Saturday afternoon, some kind of sauna peaks. But if you think of electric vehicles, that you don't have to charge them at the same time. And typically people drive with car only some tens of kilometers per day. It actually is not so much charging in one night. But then we come to the digitalization, so that how you can optimize it and have an easy way that I could say that, okay, tomorrow I have to drive 50 kilometers, take care that I have enough capacity in battery, and then I can say that tomorrow, the day after that, I have to go to Tampere, then I need full battery, and then you could the system could optimize it. But there we really need a help of the digitalization to make that happen.
More loud, please.
One of the articles I read that the emission responsible for reduced battery for the EV car is around 80, it's similar to like 80,000 kilometers of gasoline emissions are equal to that. So taking into account that guarantee for battery is also around 5 years,
Now it was a question about the emissions related to the battery production, and then the sustainability if the battery lifetime is some 5 years. I think the guarantee varies. Now it's in some cars it's 8 years, so it's also improving, and also the energy densities in the batteries is improving. So what we can see is really a development happening in the batteries and improving all the time. So we are just in the beginning of this change, So if we already now can see that it's if you had this 80,000 kilometers is something like is to comparable, so it's after 2-3 years it's much better. So I can see that it's clearly much more sustainable when we go forward. And if you think what we have not talked about, the local emissions in the cities, So the impact is there also huge.
Is there a question? Please.
Is there any legislation that Fortum would prefer to see in European level or Finnish level with this
strategy? There was a question whether we would like to see some legislation to move forward in, I would say, in the solar economy. I would say perhaps a couple of things. First of all, emissions trading is very efficient way to reduce emissions. But now the limit has been too low. So we should increase the target, then the CO2 price would be higher, and it would make many, many actions much more feasible than they are nowadays. That is one thing. Then another thing is related to the flexibility, because now the whole electricity price includes the energy, transmission and distribution, and taxes. And this is actually Finnish thing, that if we could introduce a taxation which is relative to the energy cost, so that when the energy cost is low, that means that you have excess electricity available, then the tax would be low. But when there is deficit of power, then also the tax would be high. And that would make these flexibility actions more feasible, and we could introduce more those actions. So these two things came to my mind immediately.
So, anything else? There's been a lot of questions so far. I will make one. So, you had in one of the first slides, there was a CCS, carbon capture and storage systems. Is Fortum somehow active in those these days?
We have participated in research and development in that area, and technologically it's working. But then the question is how to make it feasible. And I think quite normal consensus is that if the CO2 price would be 50 euros per ton, it would be feasible. But if we think globally of the climate change perspective, we should be able to introduce carbon capture to be able to achieve the targets. But perhaps it's not anymore carbon capture and storage, but it's a CCU, carbon capture and usage, so that we could reuse them and circulate. So that might be the future.
Which kind of ideas there are about this reuse?
We are not active in Fortum in the reuse of carbon, but I think there are many startups, and some companies talk that you could then produce, for example, plastics of that. And then in Lappeenranta University Technology, they are producing methane from the carbon from the air. So I see there are a lot of initiatives, and luckily it is so, because then you can find some interesting areas what really could then become feasible.
So, it was very lively discussion, and I thank you everybody for this activity, and let's give one more good applause to our speaker today.
Thank you.